You've been seeing this one already before, a PC-based think line by German manufacturer IGEL Technology. And while last time I made it to run with Windows XP embedded, I thought it to be a good showcase as well for Windows fundamentals for legacy P. Nah, never mind. Obsolete computer technology is my passion. I'm the vintage collector, and these are my stories. When Microsoft released Windows Fundamentals for legacy PCs in 2006, they were responding to a big problem. Many businesses and organizations still had fleets of aging, underpowered hardware that couldn't realistically handle Windows XP, not to even speak about Windows Vista. Windows FLP was built as a bridge. It was based on Windows XP Embedded, a modular version of Windows XP originally designed for specialized devices like ATMs, cash registers, terminal clients, and more. XP Embedded allowed system builders to selectively include only the necessary components to slim down the OS, and I have been exploring this into more detail in a previous episode. So it's only natural to have another look at its spin-off sibling, Windows Fundamentals for Legacy PCs today. FLP was strictly a volume licensing product aimed at businesses trying to extend the life of older machines, typically Pentium MMX and Pentium 2 machines with a minimal clock speed of 233 MHz and 64 MB of RAM on the lower end. While essentially being a trimmed down Windows XP at heart, it was a mere hack for businesses to buy time before lifecycling their older machines, where continuing to run them with Windows 98 and Windows 2000 posed serious security threats. On a side note, there was also Windows XP Embedded POS Ready 2009 focused on point of sale systems. Interestingly, when XP support ended, some home users will later exploit POS Ready 2009 updates to unofficially patch their regular XP installation, but that's a story for another day. As FLP was released in 2006, about 6 months before the release of the seemingly unpopular heavyweight Windows Vista, Windows Fundamentals for legacy PCs only saw a direct successor by 2011 with Windows Thin PC. Based on Windows 7 embedded standard, Windows Thin PC served the same mission: to provide a lightweight environment for legacy hardware, of course, this time round targeting slightly more capable machine than its predecessor. Said that, I didn't expect it to be a big issue to install Windows FLP onto my dated thin client. I mean, after all, it's a legacy PC, right? As seen during my previous episode, I had done the standard install of regular Windows XP. If you remember, I had done so to get a full capture of the installed hardware devices using tap.exe, which came from the XP Embedded SDK. This, in turn, produced a device database that I could import into XP Embedded's target designer to have it include the required device drivers. Not doing so would result in getting an inaccessible boot device stop error when booting XP Embedded. However, even though Windows Fundamentals for legacy PC was spun off from XP Embedded, I expected it to be a bit more complete. But apparently not, as, opposed to the full version of Windows XP, it would expose the same issue as the stock version of XP Embedded, leading to a blue screen. Since I had already gone through all the driver hassles for XP Embedded, I knew where to obtain the matching wire drivers. I took the same known working driver for the IDE controller and copied it onto a floppy disk. But yeah, that wouldn't work, because apparently that driver wasn't intended to be used for XP Texmo setup, neither for vanilla Windows XP nor for the FLP version. Apparently, the TXTSETUP.OEM file was missing. And it was missing from literally every alternate driver version I inspected. so there was no other way than trying to create the TXTSETUP.OEM file myself. I went by reading through documentation and inspecting the supplied INF file as a reference. Of course, I introduced one or two glitches along the way, like here where the driver wasn't found due to a typo. To streamline the procedure, I started using VirtualBox. Of course, I couldn't emulate the via IDE controller in VirtualBox, but it helped me verify the custom driver disk for syntactical errors, with this being the final version. Eventually, I was confident enough to retry it on the real hardware again. Let's look again. Here's the vanilla FLP without a driver disk bailing out into a stop error right away. And here's the outcome for a faulty driver disk, in this case using the via IDE miniport drive for Windows 2000 and XP. Obviously, it would load but not be sufficient to detect the compact flash. And no, this wasn't the driver I had used for XP embedded before, just an alternative I tried for testing. Finally, here's the driver I had used to build my custom XP embedded setup, now with my own custom TXTSETUP.OEM file. Not only was it successfully loaded, but it was also sufficient to detect the compact flash and install Windows FLP to it. However, after the first reboot, it would still end up in an inaccessible boot device stop error. So even though my custom configuration was good enough to perform the installation, the driver wasn't correctly installed. Although I included the standard INF file as well as the driver catalog file, it was obviously not intended for text mode setup. And if you're thinking now about using the DOS-based winnt.exe setup for overcoming this, nope. The DOS installer is no longer available for Windows FLP. Windows FLP, like Windows PosReady 2009, uses Windows image format files for installation, a technique that would only reach the mainstream with Windows Vista, but was already used before for niche products like XP Embedded. Maybe one could patch the WIM file using MHX from the Windows ADK. Maybe the .in file needs a similar tweak to make the driver installable on FLP, like the one I had to do for the graphics driver on XP Embedded. But honestly, no. The line must be drawn somewhere. Let me know in the comments.
Seriously, you're giving up?
Okay. You still want to see Windows FLP in action, right? Alright, let's pull another machine, because I wasted countless hours with the via drivers and I'm really not making any progress here. Let's try this good old Asus EeePC 701 4G from 2007. The EeePC was the device that kicked off the entire netbook hype even before Intel officially coined the term a few months later. Still, sporting a meager 512MB of memory, an Intel Celeron underclock to 600MHz and a tiny 4GB flash, it definitely falls into the specs for Windows FLP. And I'm more than happy to report Windows FLP installs just fine. After running through the first boot assistant, which you might recognize from Windows XP Embedded, you'll end up on the Windows XP desktop. Of course, it's a heavily trimmed down desktop experience, but still fairly complete from a general usability point of view. It includes utilities like Notepad, Calculator, Explorer, and of course Device Manager, which points out at a few unknown hardware components, but installing drivers is no different than with regular Windows XP. Microsoft eventually also released Service Pack 3 for FLP. But beware, do not use the regular XP Service Pack 3. There's a special version specifically tailored for Windows fundamentals for legacy PCs. Of course, it's quite dense on the tiny 4GB flash. After installing the service pack, about half the disk space is already used up. But even on the EeePC, there's still enough room to install lightweight applications like the MyPal browser, a Firefox 68-based browser that's still maintained today and lets you browse the modern web. Whether you want to do that is another story. It's a daunting and slow experience. It took several minutes just to load up my YouTube channel. Still, I totally see the use for Windows fundamentals for legacy PCs from a mid-2000s perspective. Even a lower machine could still be useful, if only as a thin client for Windows Terminal services. Now guess which topic I'm about to explore soon. Anyway, what do you think about Windows FLP? Share your shenanigans in the comments section. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching, and see you again next Sunday.